Do you want to finally understand the matrices in neural networks and how you can go from this calculation speed to this? Let's do it. Hey guys, it's Key with Key Codes. We talked about the very basics of math in neural networks and built our first neural network from scratch in my last video. And today we will speed things up a bit. If you have absolutely no idea how the math in a neural network works, make sure to watch my first video. We will start with accelerating the math of one neuron. After that, we look at how this works for a multi-layer network, and at the end, we will see how fast all of this really gets. The activation value, that's what's going into the activation function inside a neuron, is calculated like this. All the inputs are multiplied with their associated weights. So I1 times W1, I2 times W2, and so on. And on top of it, we add the bias. We can write this with two vectors like this and using the dot product in between them. If you have no idea what a dot product is, I'll show you. So if I have a vector 1, 2, 3 and another one 4, 5, 6, the dot product of these is the sum of 1 times 4, 2 times 5 and 3 times 6. It's the sum of the product of their elements, which equals 32. Easy. And this can be used to calculate the activation value because the activation value is the sum of the products of inputs and weights. One holds the inputs, the other one holds the weights, dot product, boom, same as before. The one thing that's not inside the vectors right now is the bias. A simple trick is just to add one to the start of the inputs and squeeze that bias into the weights. Like this, there is a 1 times bias inside of our sum now, and that's what we need. Now we stuff all of this into an activation function, and like this we get a full-fledged neuron again, but this time with vectors. Next, we will add some more neurons. Alrighty, let's say we have 3 neurons with 3 shared inputs. The notation for the weights works like this. W23 means weight for the second input in the third neuron. If we were to write this down in vector notation, it looks like this. So we got some inputs coming in, they get dot producted with the weights and the bias of each neuron. After that, we put everything through our activation function and we get the output. Nothing new here. If we write the weights here in column vectors instead, then it's a matrix multiplication. You don't know what I mean? Alright, matrix multiplication. Matrix multiplication works like this. Let's say we have 2 matrices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7, 8, 9, 0. To multiply them, we dot product each row of the first matrix with each column of the second matrix. So for the first element in the first row of the result, we dot product the first row and the first column. 1 times 7 plus 2 times 9 equals 25. And for the second element in the first row, we use the first row and the second column. 1 times 8 plus 2 times 0 equals 8. Got it? Okay, one last example to make sure. Second row, first element? Correct. We use the second row of the first matrix and dot product it with the first column of the second matrix. 3 times 7 plus 4 times 9 equals 57. Exactly. Let's quickly do it for all the remaining combinations. Done. And how does this apply to our layer of neurons, you might ask? Okay, on one hand we have the input. On the other hand, we have our matrix of weights and biases. Now we multiply this row of inputs with the first column in our matrix, which is neuron 1. After that, with the second column, neuron 2. And finally, with the third column, which is neuron 3. And we have our activation values for our neurons again. Amazing. But this time everything is stored in one vector.
Wow, you are still watching this video. Nice. There will be more about neural nets in the future. So hit the subscribe button and don't miss the next one. If you want to talk to fellow coders and me, join our Discord. I love to see you there. The link is in the description below. We have done everything we could do before, but this time we used matrices and vectors. Sorry for over-explaining, but I remember when I first came around this, it needed a little time to click. If it helped, hit like. And now let's add another layer.
2 neurons coming in, fully connected to the first layer. Each of them has 3 inputs. I did change the notation a bit. B11 stands for bias layer 1, neuron 1. And O12, for example, means output first layer,
second neuron. The weights are now simply numbered, so W15 means layer 1, weight number 5. The input to our second layer is the output of our first layer. But before we can throw it into the matrix multiplication, we need to append a 1 for the bias of each neuron. After we have done that, we can multiply the new input for layer 2 with its weights matrix to get this layer's activation value. Putting all of this through the activation function again, and we have the output for layer 2.
You might be asking yourself, why is this important in the first place? What we have done until now is to vectorize our math for the neural network evaluation. So we reduced the number of mathematical operations by using vectors and matrices, which helps to speed things up tremendously. After we put in the brain power to go from basic math to vectorizing everything, we can now use a special subset of instructions for our CPU or our GPU to parallelize all the calculations. So instead of going row 1, column 1, dot product, and then row 1, column 2, and so on, we can just calculate it all at once. Done. This makes it blazing fast and all the deep learning stuff you use from day to day possible in the first place. So here is the part some of you have been waiting for all this video. How can we do it? We will use a math library for Python called NumPy, which makes using vectors and matrices a lot easier. It is highly optimized for speed. Let's write some code.
The first thing we got to do is to import NumPy. But before we can build our neural network with NumPy, you gotta understand how you can define and multiply two matrices. A and B are so-called NumPy arrays. This is the data type we use to define matrices. They are two-dimensional. We first have a list of rows, and inside of it we have the single rows themselves. For this to work correctly, all the rows must have the same length, because the length of the rows is defining the number of columns in our matrix. In order to multiply two matrices in NumPy, there is a function called matmul. Matmul takes our matrices as input parameters, multiplies them, and returns the results as a new matrix. 25, 8, 57. Same as before. NumPy calculated correctly.
If you haven't watched my last video, this might come to you as a surprise. But you can use a neural network to model the XOR function. Because I don't want to come up with a new example, let's just do it again. But this time with matrices and vectors.
First thing, import NumPy. Now we need two layers. The first layer has two inputs with two neurons. So our matrix has two biases and four weights, two for each neuron. And the second layer has one neuron, bias, input weights. We use a step function as our activation function. But if you remember the step function from the last video, it looked totally different. This time X is an NP array. So we want to apply the step function to all elements of it. NPWhere says everywhere in the NP array where X is bigger than 0, put a 1, else put a 0. So if you have a vector like this, each element that's bigger than 0 becomes 1, and all the others are set to 0. This works for NP arrays of all dimensions, by the way. Now, let's get to the real deal. Our neural network function gets inputs, a list of matrices for the layers, and an activation function. For the loop to work, we set our outputs to our inputs, because it's basically like the output of the previous layer. After that, we iterate over each layer in our net. We add a 1 to our outputs for the bias in this line. We do this by generating an NP array with only 1s inside of it. The shape of this array is two-dimensional, and it has one column and has the same amount of rows as the output. The shape of an NP array returns the length of each dimension. If you have a matrix with 3 rows and 2 columns, it has a two-dimensional shape of 3, 2. So output shape 0 returns the number of rows of the outputs matrix. This way we get a column vector with exact the right size to append it in front of the outputs. And that's what NP HStack does. HStack stands for horizontal stack. So we stack two NP arrays horizontally to get a new NP array. And that's the new input to our layer. So we multiply the inputs with the current layer matrix, put everything through the activation function, and drumroll, get the output for our layer. We then start again for the second layer, appending the ones, multiplication, activation function, done. This is the output of our neural net, which we can return. Let's test it. We define all the inputs for the XOR function. Here is the input-output table for everyone who doesn't know what an XOR function looks like. And now we iterate over all the possible inputs, calling our net with all of them, handing in the layers and the activation function, and printing the result next to the input. Bam! Our super-fast neural net calculated the XOR function correctly. But we can do more. Because we use matrix multiplication, we can hand in all the inputs at once. Remember, in matrix multiplication, we dot product all the rows, which are our inputs, with all the columns, which are our nodes, or neurons. So we get a matrix with all the results for all the neurons for all our inputs after the first layer, which we can then feed into the next layer to get all the results of our neural net in just two steps. Incredible. Here is the code to put all the inputs at once as an NP array through our neural net. And like this, we get the same results even faster.
Okay, I simplified stuff here a little. It is not all 100% in parallel. It all depends if you are doing it on your CPU or GPU, and also on the size of the matrices and with which library, for instance, NumPy is linked. But I think you got the idea why it should be a lot faster. Let's see how fast it really is. Next, we will compare a normal stepwise matrix multiplication with NumPy's matmul.
We start with our matrices from our multiplication example again. Now, we need a stepwise matrix multiplication. It basically goes through each row of the first matrix and each column of the second matrix and, yeah, does the dot products. Boring. If you want to have a closer look, the GitHub repo with all the code from this video is, by the way, linked in the description. Let's see if NumPy and our stepwise implementation return the same results first. Looks good. We need a little benchmark. We go from a 1x1 matrix up to a 100x100 matrix and multiply it with itself. To do this, we first need a random matrix. NP_random_rand does the job. We then convert it to a normal list of lists, because that's what our stepwise implementation needs. Now we measure the time NumPy needs to multiply the matrix with itself, and after that how long the stepwise implementation needs. We save all of this into a list and print it out. I also want to plot this, because it is more impressive if you see the graph rather than just looking at the terminal output and comparing numbers. So I import matplotlib and fetch all the NumPy durations and all the stepwise durations from the results and throw them onto a plot. Let's run it. That's quite a difference for a 100x100 matrix. NumPy needs approximately 0.0001 seconds to multiply the matrix with itself. The stepwise implementation is with 0.17 seconds, 1700 times slower. Whoops. And look at this. In orange, you see the increase in computation time of our stepwise implementation. And blue is NumPy. Convinced? Good.
NumPy on its own doesn't use your GPU though. For calculating neural networks on your GPU, there are more specialized frameworks like TensorFlow and PyTorch. But these will be the topics for future videos, so better subscribe. If you want to speed up your NumPy code by using your GPU, check out QPy, which is a NumPy implementation using CUDA. Don't forget to hit the like button if you got some value out of this video and join the Discord. Here are some more videos for you to watch while you are waiting for your stepwise multiplication function to finally finish. Until then, have a lot of fun, coders!